So hello and happy Friday to you. Thanks for joining me. Today is Friday, February 21st, and this is Beginner Backyard Beekeeping Questions and Answers, episode 52. This is The Way to Bee. So if you have any questions of your own, please feel free to write them down in the comment section in this video. And if you want to know what we're going to talk about today so that you're not wasting your time, please look down in the video description and you'll see what we're going to talk about, subjects that we're going to cover. So I hope you're interested. I hope you stick around. And if you have questions or comments, always welcome. And maybe if you post a question that's something many people may want to know about, we'll talk about it next weekend. So we're going to jump right into this. It is only 21 degrees, by the way, outside, even though the sun is shining, so I'll take that. But still too cold to do anything in the bee yard around here. The first question today comes from Just Jake. He says, I don't have my bees yet, and I watched your video on queen excluders. I have the Flow-Hive. Could I do an upper entrance? And as a new guy, I'm paranoid about brood in my Flow-Hive. So for those of you who don't know, the Flow-Hive is just another hive design that has a honey super on top that has a mechanized frame in it. This is one right back there. And without a queen excluder, this is a little cutout piece of one, is just a piece of plastic, sometimes it's metal, and it's designed so that worker bees can get through it, but the queen would be blocked. Also, what else can't get up in there? Drones, because they're big and fat too. So if the queen excluder is underneath your flow super, then the queen's not gonna get up in there and lay eggs. But if you don't have the queen excluder, I've got a video that shows that the queen can potentially lay eggs, and guess what? Brood can actually hatch in those plastic cells. So this is an understandable concern that Jake has. So could he just put an upper entrance? So if you had your brood box down, always build up your brood first before putting on your flow super. And when you put the flow super on, beginners should always put that queen excluder in there because we don't want eggs messing up the system there. So if there were an upper entrance, what's the advantage? Well, the advantage is that the bees can come and go from that upper entrance if they're foraging, and they can bring their resources in without going through the brood frames down below. So they would no longer use the landing board to get in and out, although they could. The video that Jake is talking about, years ago, I did tests with different queen excluders, and we used the plastic ones. We did not use the metal ones, although I should probably repeat the test and do that. And what I did is outside, we put sugar syrup in a feeder, and we put the queen excluders on top and tried to see how much difficulty worker bees have getting through them to access that sugar. So of course we had bumblebees and everything all over it trying to get in, and we know they can't get in. But it was amazing to me how many of the workers not only struggled to get through that screen, that queen excluder, but how many of the worker bees actually could not get through it. So that tells us that when we use a queen excluder, we are reducing the efficiency of the bees going from outside to the honey supers. So if you remove a queen excluder, there are some risks involved because you could have eggs being laid up in your honey super. So you don't want to do that. And this is why a lot of beekeepers, myself included, in the past, I used to put upper entrances on almost all of my hives. And they were widely used by the foragers, definitely. But another thing comes up when we're talking about the flow hive or any beehive when you have that going on. Once you put the queen excluder in, if you provide an alternate entrance up above, and let's say that your hive swarms and you don't know about it, well, the queen, the virgin queen that hatches after the old queen has left when your colony swarms, she flies out and does mating flights. Usually it's about three different mating flights. Now, what happens if the queen comes back now? The virgin queen, now that she's been mated, returns to her colony and enters your hive through that upper entrance. Now you've got a queen that can't get down into the brood frames where the nurse bees are, and she might lay her eggs exclusively in your upper frames, in your honey supers. So there are things to think about when you are providing an upper entrance with a queen excluder involved. So you can do the upper entrance. I have already made a video about that, Flow-Hive adding an upper entrance, and I'll show you how I did that. So I will put that video in there too. And for those of you who want to see the queen excluder and how it holds back a lot of bees, I will put that link also in the video description down below for your convenience. So what's my answer for Jake? You can do it. Be careful with it. Use that open space. The other thing is the way the gabled roof is on the flow hives, there's a big open area up there. So if you have the entrance there, then the bees can do burr comb up in that space as well while they're going in and out. And that's not the end of the world. It's just something you're gonna have to scrape out as you work with your bees, but it would in fact prevent the queen from getting up in there and laying eggs. So that's a good question. I hope I answered it. And again, a more thorough answer is probably in the video that's linked in the description. Next one comes from Steve Kleinman, and he printed, put a note that I printed out the question because it was so long. Steve Kleinman, since spring 2019, I installed a bee package into a 10 frame deep. The population expanded and eventually I added a second 10 frame deep. The number of frames in the box is, that's what they mean by 10 frames. There are 10 frames inside that box, and the deep is the deeper box, which is normally used for brood. My bees have overwintered with those two deeps and supplemental feeding. Spring 2020 is arriving. Sure is. Can't wait. I presume that my overwintered bee population has dwindled, and when I open my hive, I will find that two deeps are no longer appropriate. How do I consolidate back into one deep? If more than 10 frames have brood, do I keep both deeps on but use a queen excluder between them until the brood box? Now this is interesting. So if he has over 10 frames of brood with a brood box, he wants to know, should he consolidate everything down into one box in spring and how to manage that? Should there be a queen excluder? Because if you consolidate all the brood down below and you know the queen's down there, you can keep her there by putting your queen excluder in. And of course, we just talked about the queen excluder. By the way, this is a small version of it. It would cover the entire space between those boxes. I would not put the queen excluder in under those circumstances. If you've already got 10 frames of brood, then I would maybe center the brood. So I would have 5 and 5 and use both of those boxes and then have the space for expansion outboard of those center frames. That now 5 frames of brood, very efficient for the cluster, very efficient for the workers and nurse bees. Then later, as the summer continues and they start to fill the upper space with honey, and that naturally drives them down and they start keeping their brood in the lower boxes, then that's when you can put your queen excluder on if you really want to. Or, because this is what I do anyway, I'm living in the north. It's cold here. I'm in the northeastern United States in what's called the Snow Belt along Lake Erie. And I'm at 1,300 feet above sea level, for those of you who have to know that kind of thing. And what happens is I use the first two boxes for the bees anyway. So whether there's eggs in either of those two boxes is of no consequence to me because I'm not pulling off the honey. So you could let both of those boxes just build up and fill out. Now, if they start to concentrate in the second box up and they're putting all the resources and they continue to use those frames for brood, and they don't start to fill the lower box, you can swap them out. So put the more occupied with the most brood, that in your bottom box, and then the resources that are surplus that they're going to expand into should be the next box up, because they naturally move up until they start to fill that with honey and then they kind of backfill. I hope that makes sense. But me personally, I would not put the queen excluder in at all because there's only two boxes to begin with. So it's just a matter of which box you want to orient as the lower box. So most of the brood resources would start to move down lower anyway. And why is that? It's because the bees, the queen, and the nurse bees like to have the brood where the box is the most ventilated as we get into spring. So they will be nearer the entrance, and then away from the entrance, they start to save their honey resources and they start to expand with new comb as well. So wherever there's an entrance to the hive, into a building, into a tree, the first thing that you encounter are the brood frames, and then the honey stored resources are further away from that entrance. So if that helps, bee biology wise, they just naturally stick close to the entrance. So me personally, 10 frames though, yeah, I wouldn't put a queen excluder in there. Because they've used all the space. They need resources, they need nectar, and also they're going to be storing pollen. So the pollen, if you got 10 frames of brood, they're going to have immediate access to the pollen too. So that's why I suggest you can do anything you want. I suggest condensing it to 5 brood frames directly above one another and let them expand out their resources. And it's funny that in my boxes, they expand their resources to the east side of the box, which is funny. So they do that first, and then they expand honey resources to the west side of the box last, so that morning sun must have some impact on them. So there's that answer. The next one is from Robbie Cohen. Could you go into some detail as to how to orient the better bee comb within the frames? So for those of you who don't know, Better Bee last year started selling some synthetic beeswax, which is pre-drawn comb. This stuff acts exactly like, it feels like real beeswax. But what it is, it's a food grade synthetic material that is supposed to be completely safe, and the cells are all completely drawn out. And I've found through my experimenting through the last year with it that the bees do use this exactly like their own honeycomb. So this question about how it should go in, this stuff, it looks, you know, like a perfect rectangle, but there are some details about it that you might want to know. One is, when you look at the end of the cells, and I hope this goes into focus here. When you look at the end of the cells there, they're shaped in a V. So the cells themselves are angled down from both sides. And this is interesting too, if you've ever really looked at honeycomb when you cut it out, their cells are also slightly angled, and that's because when the nectar is wet and watery, it will settle in, and then as it becomes more viscous, then they're going to cap it off when it becomes honey. But so these cells definitely have an upside. So the V side, this should be up, the V should be pointed down. And there again, when you look at this thing from the sides, it also has a slight taper to the whole thing. So the narrow side of the taper would go in the frame first. And there's something else I want to talk to you about regarding these Better Comb frames by Better Bee. Make sure to identify the frames that you put this stuff in with the Better Comb label, because you may forget when you start pulling apart your bee boxes later. You do not want to be using this synthetic material, which will in all ways look just like regular honeycomb. You want to make sure it's in a frame that is clearly marked as Better Comb by Better Bee, so that you don't use this stuff when you're trying to render wax. If you're making cut comb, if this is going to be in your upper boxes where honey gets stored, make sure to absolutely mark it. There are studies going on right now that may show that the bees are starting to blend this material with some of the wax in their shallow supers where the nectar is stored and where people draw it off for honey. It does not affect the honey, but for those who are using wax resources, if you're doing cut comb or if you're going to make beeswax candles, you need to be able to say that it is what it is. You do not want that to be tainted with the synthetic material that these are made from. These things work fantastic, but me personally, I'm only going to be using them down in my brood boxes to kick off fast development of the, if I collect a swarm, if I've done a split and I want them to start fast and I don't already have pre-drawn comb. So for the beginning beekeeper who has boxes of, you know, frames for their bees to build on, but does not have drawn out comb, Better Comb by Better Bee is a very good choice, and just fill the center 3 or 4 frames with it in your box, 8 or 10 frame box, whatever you're using, and then let the foundationless or the other foundations that you're going to use outboard of that. And then as the bees get settled and started and their brood kicks in and the foragers start going crazy, then they'll start to expand out to the sides. So this stuff has worked very well. I installed late season swarms with it. They used it just like their own beeswax. And the advantage is, a queen gets in here. If you install a package of bees today, by tomorrow morning or the next day, you're going to already see eggs in these cells. You're going to already see the bees storing their pollen resources and putting nectar in here. And it is a very fast way to build up either a split which most beginning beekeepers are not doing splits, but if you've just got your package or you've just got your nucs, if you have nucs, you probably don't need them. Because when you get a nucleus colony of bees, they already have brood frames, they already have capped brood, they already have drawn comb, and they're already, you know, very well started. So I would say this is the best for two things: swarms or packaged bees that come and you're just starting out and you don't have pre-drawn comb or ready for them to occupy. But those are the details. The other thing is I did a whole video on how to install this in the frames, and it's held in place by toothpicks. And I will put a link to that video also down in the video description today. For those of you who are interested and want to see how the bees use it, I do that all in one video. So it's also called hexacomb. So if you look that up and you think, oh, that looks just like, you know, Bettercomb by Betterbee. Hexacomb is Bettercomb. It's just, it's made in Hungary and it's marketed in the United States from Betterbee through Bettercomb through Betterbee.com. Tongue twister there. So that's how to orient it. The V down, and then on the edges, there's a slight tilt to it. Slide that in first and put a solid surface under it. So when you're pushing it down and installing it, that's in the video. Next one is from Wendy Bachman. Bees are up in the top feeder and took a peek on a recent sunny day. Is it okay for me to put on 2-to-1 sugar syrup or dry sugar? Days are in the 40s, 20s for the lows. Thank you for sharing about Weaver Queens. I'm very impressed with them. Okay. So Weaver Queens, by the way, are coming out of Texas from the BeeWeaver family. There are two Weaver sellers in Texas. B-E-E, Weaver, W-E-A-V-E-R. Those are the queens that we use here. They are survivor stock, hygienic, varroa resistant. They can go treatment free. So the other thing is, it's still 20 degrees, okay, sometimes. So I do not recommend liquid feed. I recommend that you stay with dry feed for now because it's still freezing. What happens if we put a bunch of liquid in there? So dry feed, and this is fed in the top. There's a hive top feeder here that's described. So most people have either an empty medium box or they have a feeder shim of some kind that creates a space above your top box, because now all these bees are up in the top already and they're already feeding on these emergency resources. So I would say still at this time of the year, and I'm not sure where Wendy is located, but if it's down in the 20s, the bees cannot get out, cannot do cleansing flights, and they would have a problem with all that additional moisture this time of year. So if you're going to put on dry sugar, that's just fine. I wouldn't be quick to put in 2-to-1 syrup. Generally, 2-to-1 syrup, which is 2 parts sugar, 1 part water, would be fed in the fall, just before the temperatures start dropping and while the resources are falling off. So the bees get a lot of energy out of that with a high sugar content. So, and those wrap-it-around feeders can be used for dry feed by pulling out that center cone, or they can use liquid feed. So you can transition that too. So as the weather does warm up and you stop getting those below freezing temps at nighttime, if you've got sugar in that reservoir, you can add water to that and mix it up, and you haven't lost the sugar and you've converted it to syrup, and the bees will use that once the temperatures are warm for good. So that's my advice there. Don't do the 2-to-1 sugar syrup or even the 1-to-1. Do dry feeding right now. Number 5, R. Philly. To add a hive to my apiary and build up a hive for honey production, what would work best? Number 1, use my spring splits with or without a queen to start a new hive, or 2, purchase a 3-pound package with the queen. Both scenarios would have fully drawn comb to work with. So that's a good advantage to have fully drawn comb in surplus, ready to go. So the first option here is to do a split with an overwintered queen. Now, by the way, health-wise, adaptation to your environment-wise, using the queen and the colony that's come through winter, that's still going gangbusters, what is a split? Well, you set up a second hive box, landing board, brood box usually, and then you're going to have an inner cover and you're going to have a cover on that. And there's already pre-drawn comb to put in there. So they'll open up the box that's got the hive that's thriving, And if you pull out the brood frames there and stick those in the new box, and then you take the empty frames from the new box, because it's full of pre-drawn comb too, you swap those out and you push the remaining brood frames all together in the box that you're pulling your split from. Now you can take the queen and put her in the new box, or you can leave the queen there, but you need to look for queen cells. Also, if you're going to be doing that kind of split, make sure there's lots of drones around. If there aren't, when the new queen hatches in your new split, she won't have anybody to mate with. So you want to do this going into a nectar flow when the numbers are big, which is why we're doing the split anyway. And now what's going to happen? One of those new cells is going to hatch either in the old box or in the new box. Wherever the queen goes, the other box is going to produce a replacement for her. So, and there's already brood. There has to be brood or this won't work. So this is a delayed method. In other words, what do we have to wait for? The established group already has a queen that's laying, so that production continues. You can also have some hatching brood because you're going to put capped brood into the new box as well. They're going to be hatching out. They're going to be going right to work. But you're not going to have replacement stock for a minimum of probably 30 days in the hive that does not have the queen. So we've got a gap there. We've got a brood gap. That's the slow route. There's a delay. Now, there's an advantage to it, though, because when the virgin queen hatches out from the split, she's going to fly out and she's going to mate with local stock somewhere. She may fly for miles to a drone congregation area, and she's going to mate, do maybe three of those flights and come back with having been mated with up to 20 different drones. So she has great genetics with her when she comes back. The only downside is, of course, the delay in production. If you buy in this package, so we got a 3-pound package coming in, you already have all the drawn comb. So you're leaving your other colony intact and just expanding to make room for their expansion, for their number increase in the spring. And then instead, starting a new box with a package of bees. Is that the faster buildup? It sure is. And that's because there's already drawn comb. We're going into a nectar flow. The queen is already fertile and already laying, and there's already a workforce of 3 pounds of bees. So that's actually going to build up much faster because that queen is going to start laying in those cells in those frames as soon as the resources start coming through the door, through the landing board, through that entrance. So as soon as the pollen comes in and there's nectar, they're going to take right off. So actually the package is a much faster buildup than doing the split. But again, the queen that you bought in, wherever that comes from, so if that's your stock, that has changed the stock in your apiary potentially, depending on what you buy. And there is an advantage health-wise and adaptation to your climate-wise by doing the split and letting those hatch out, and then that virgin queen goes off and mates with something else that survived through the winter. So now we've got two winter-hardy colonies of bees going. So it's just a matter of how fast you need them to build up. So those are the options. I hope I answered that. And this is for honey production. So if you're really trying to kick the honey production and get that going, then the split is the slower route. And the package might yield. By the way, when we bought in Saskatras packages last year, they produced huge amounts of honey. So they built right up. Some people were talking recently about the number of pounds of worker bees that you can put in there that can increase. And you can actually get honey the first year. Well, even with a 3-pound package in the right area, you're going to get honey your first year in surplus. So it's all, you know, this is agriculture. So it depends on what kind of weather conditions we have, what kind of nectar flow we have, you know, and then, of course, the bee's ability to take advantage of that. A larger workforce takes advantage of things quicker, but a queen is going to be laying from 1,000 to 1,500 eggs a day. So you bought in that package, they started laying right away. So how many days before they start hatching out? So if you say 25 days out, you're going to see a real boost in that workforce. So you're going to, and of course, every day beyond that. So 21 days out from the time an egg is laid, by the time they're hatching out, you have 1,000 to 1,500 new bees every single day hatching out in that colony. And that's going to be a very fast buildup. So I hope I answered that question. Next one is from Sammy George. At 72, I'm a complete greenhorn. I only want one hive my first year, and I've decided on a horizontal hive using Langstroth frames. How many frames should I use that allow for growth? I'm thinking deep frames for brood and medium for honey. And then goes on to ask questions about sizing it and everything. So I'm not sure if Sammy George here is building the horizontal Langstroth hive or is buying one in. Most people are building them. They're very simple to do. And here's the thing. I have to be honest and say, I don't have one. I don't have a Langstroth hive in service. But these are my notes because I'm making my own. Those are my hive stand designs. And what I've done, you know, there are a couple of things that are very easy, in my opinion, to answer here. And one is about combining deep frames with shallow frames. So normally, this is for a medium super. And then a deep frame is like this one right here that we showed with this better comb. Throw that on the floor for a second. So here's a deep frame. Here's a medium frame. See the differences. Now, the whole point of the horizontal hive, especially the horizontal Langstroth hive, is that the entire hive uses these frames because already these have a lot of compatible equipment with them, so it is a very good standard size to start with. And if we're going to do the whole thing horizontal, the first question is, how many frames? Well, most of the people will say that you want at least 32 frames. That doesn't mean when you put together your horizontal hive that you stock it with 32 frames right off the bat. No, you stock it with only 8 or 10 of these frames. Then you have a solid board following behind it that is called a follow board, and your entrance is out the side or the end, depending on what design you're going to follow. And then you let them build up and occupy that space, and as they start to fill those frames, that's when you move your follow board out and you continue to add frames. So I have a problem with the idea of putting in medium frames as well, because now we have a box that's designed for this large frame, and we're going to put some medium frames in here for honey. Now my question, I guess, is why would we even do that? One of these frames full of honey is about 10 pounds if it's a deep frame, so even a medium. The only reason to go with medium frames is because we're usually having to lift a box full of them. That's about 47 pounds, give or take, if you have a medium super that's full of honey. So for a lot of people, that's a lot to deal with. But when you were dealing with a horizontal hive, the thing is, we're only pulling out one frame at a time. So if you can lift that 10 pounds, you're pretty much good to go. The other thing is, if we've got the space underneath here, so let's say we built that horizontal hive for the deep frames, and instead we put these in, what are the bees going to do with that extra space? Oh, look. They might start to fill that space themselves. So they'll start to build extra comb hanging off the bottom because they're going to fill a space if it goes beyond bee space. So if you have a big opening under here, the other thing is you can modify the box and make it skinnier down the end. So you could have a shallower box, although, you know, for construction purposes, you can use a 2x12, 4 foot or 5 foot length, and those are the sides, the top, and the bottom, and build a very simple horizontal hive. And then why would you want to use shorter frames in it? So I would suggest, if you go a little over 4 feet in length, you can handle 32 frames. Now mine is going 5 feet. Don't ask me why, I just want to make it 5 feet long. But how did I come up with the space around it? So I'm going to show you my sketch here. And hopefully that's in focus, and you can see the dimensions on there. What I did was I used the full-size deep Langstroth frame as my guide. Outboard of that, I used bee space. So if we look at the way the frame hangs down here, I used a 3/8 of an inch bee space over here and a 3/8 of an inch bee space over here. Then when it comes to the depth, and of course I marked the depth of it, 9 3/16 from the top of this bar, 9 3/16 from the top of that to the bottom of this. So now I know, based on where I'm going to rest the ear of this, that that's where the bottom of the frame is going to be. So now I can allow, you know, another 3/8 inch underneath here to a 1/2 inch. It really doesn't matter. But if you give them a big open space down here, they have a tendency to fill that with burr comb. So if we restrict that to 3/8 of an inch, 3/8 of an inch, bees can be going this way and going this way at the same time. They can cross right over the top of each other. So that is how I came up with my space around my frame. And then of course, this is a 2x12 vertical, and this is two 2x12s married together for the bottom. And then I have a thinner insert. So over the top, some people lay a cloth or something directly on the tops of the frames. I'm not gonna do that. Guess what I'm doing up here? How much space am I leaving above the frames? 3/8 of an inch. Then I'm gonna have solid material above that. And then the roof of my long lang will go above that. This is a work in progress. I'm just explaining my thinking behind it. And that's pretty much it. Mine is going to be 5 feet long, and I'm going to put as many frames as I can in there. But as far as the bees know, remember, because we've got a follow board that's solid, they think the entire hive is just that space. So if you make it too small, they won't want to occupy it. So you want at least 8 frames. I'm going to start with 8 to 10. And of course, what do you think I'm going to start with? Because it's a horizontal lang, I'm going to use the Better Comb by Better Bee for the first 2 or 3 frames, because I'm going to put a package in there, and then we're going to get that started. And that's an experiment that we're going to do all through this year. So that makes it very simple. So I don't like the changing up the depth of the frames, because to me, unless I'm missing something, it doesn't really make sense. Do the whole thing deep. All the plastic frames match these dimensions. The wooden frames match these dimensions. So if you start with a frame as your guide and go out from there, up, down, and the width, and of course the length, what's the thickness of one of these? When you measure the thickness of a frame, you're going from here to here, not this actual top bar. So this one is 1 7/8. So when you're calculating how much space you need, 1 7/8 per frame. So then of course, every one of these frames is gonna butt right up against each other. I don't recommend you spread them out. I recommend you push them right tight together. And if you've got, these are acorn frames, by the way, it's another great choice when you're starting out your colony. They will, of course, draw evenly, and they serve as guides. So you can put a frame with a foundation in it right next to a foundationless frame, and then you'll let them draw that out on their own. You get a bunch of natural comb in there too. And then later, once that's all set up, you can pull out your acorn frames if you don't like plastic. So food grade plastic, good to go, triple dipped. And that's my starting spot. I've already got all my timber out there. Of course, remember, it's in the 20s right now, so it's no fun to work in the shop. I'm not one of those people that has a heated workshop. Wish I did, but I don't. So we're gonna be putting together that horizontal long lang, and we're gonna see how that goes. There are Dr. Leo, look him up if you wanna look at some other designs in horizontal hives. And he's a good guy, Dr. Leo, he knows stuff. And has a whole bunch of information, prints, everything. I think you can even buy a full unit from them too, but they are not the Langstroth standard hives. So I'm going with Langstroth because I have piles of equipment like that. And guess what? I'm building the entire hive for $100. So I went to a local lumberyard, they cut the pieces for me and everything. So that's what I'm doing this year. And those are my parameters, and I hope that answers your question. If you have any questions, just as we've said before, please go ahead and write those down in the comment section of this video. I'm sorry to wrap up so soon, but those are the questions I have to talk about. The other thing is, if you want like a coffee cup or something that has a bee on it, it says the way to bee, or a shirt, for example, it's down in the comment section below. If you want to know what the whole playlist is for these questions and answers, it's at the end of this video, and all you have to do is click on it. You'll see them all in order. One way to know the ones that you've viewed and have not viewed is click a thumbs up on it, and that will let you know when you look at that video that you've already seen it. So I hope today was helpful. I hope you can have a fantastic weekend, and I hope that there's a big warm-up headed your way. At least the sun is shining. Thanks for watching.